Good morning. Welcome to Lamb of God. Welcome to the 13th Sunday after Pentecost. It's great to have all of you here and worshiping in the sanctuary. All of you that are streaming at home, it is great to have you with us as well. We worship by the power of the Holy Spirit, and that's what you're doing at home. May He unite us together as His church here at this time and in this place. Thanks to you, all of you that participated in our blood drive on Thursday. Tim told me we collected a total of 11 units. What that means is that we helped 33 people by generosity. Isn't that something? It was enough for them to schedule another one. That was the big question. If they didn't get enough of a turnout, they weren't going to come back. Why bother? But for them, this was enough. They'll be back. Watch news and notes. We'll tell you when the next one is scheduled. Also, thank you to all of you who came to bingo yesterday. I'm sure it was fun. I wasn't able to be here, but how many did you have, Ron?
Seven.
Yeah,
it was a very low attendance, but we still had a great time.
Low attendance, but they had fun. Perhaps some of you will participate next time, and I'm sure it'll be more fun. And you can keep Ron from winning all the prizes. Right?
Ron and Carl.
Ron and Carl. Some kind of collusion going on there, huh? Coming up this week, Monday evening, we have game and euchre night. Once again, this is the chance for you to influence the kind of hymns we have. Because, Ron, what happens if Pastor loses at euchre? German. Latin. No. It's fun. Come. Starts at 5:30. We do play euchre, but there's people there that are there to play other games, so it doesn't have to be euchre. It's just fun fellowship time. That's tomorrow at 5:30. Tuesday, we have our quilters and our trustees. And then Wednesday, we're good Lutherans, and we like to eat. I certainly like to eat. We have out the lunch bunch, and it'll be at the Country Carriage in Swartz Creek. So check your news and notes for information on that. Coming up, our Bible study schedule for the next 4 weeks. We will continue having our Sunday morning 9 a.m. study as we did this morning. We pick one of the lessons that are going to be presented in worship, and we spend a little bit more time and talk about it. We talked about our epistle lesson this morning. We'll do the same thing next Sunday. But our other Bible studies, our Wednesday Bible studies, are now on hiatus for the next 4 weeks. So no Wednesday 10 a.m. Bible study, no Wednesday 7 p.m. Bible study. Coming up in September, though, September 9th, our Women's Monday Bible study on 1 Corinthians will return at the usual time at 1 o'clock. And then our Wednesday Bible studies will return on September 18th. Watch your news and notes for information on that. Our 10 a.m. Bible study on Lifelight Bible study will go back into Ezekiel and finish that book up. Wednesday 7 p.m., only the Lord knows what that's going to be. But if you have suggestions, I'm open to them. Text me, write me a note, talk to me after worship. I'm considering and looking for input on what we could do. We have an Arts and Crafts Festival coming up September 14th. We have a church auction plan for October 13th. Check your news and notes about those things. And then coming up on Sunday, September 8th, we will be celebrating Patriots Day. That is the day of remembrance of 9/11. We'll do that by a short video and a prayer at the beginning of service. And then we would like to, at that time, honor all those who have protected our country. That could mean the armed forces. That could mean first responders. Anybody that has served or is serving and those kind of things, I'll ask you to stand. And then after service, we're going to have a short ceremony out on the front lawn. We're going to retire the flag that's now flying and put up a new one. The Girl Scouts will be here to help with that. It'll be a very short service, but those of you that come for worship are invited to come on out. It's a nice way for us to present to the public what we do, that we worship and gather in the name of the Lord, and we are thankful for His gift of this country. We need volunteers to host upcoming fellowship hours. There's a sign-up sheet on the bulletin board, and there's other things. Check your news and notes for information about those. With that all out of the way, the peace of the Lord be with you always. Take a moment and share that peace with one another. Wave of the hand, left to right, front and back, and wave to the camera so we can share that peace with those that are worshiping at home. With that, let's begin our time of worship with our opening hymn, Blessed Jesus, at your word. You can remain seated until the appropriate time in that hymn. Please stand as you are able. Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
If you, O Lord, kept a record of sins, O Lord, who could stand?
But with you there is forgiveness, therefore you are feared.
Since we are gathered to hear God's word, to call upon him in prayer and praise, and to receive the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ in the fellowship of this altar, let us first consider our unworthiness and confess before God and one another that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed, and that we cannot free ourselves from our sinful condition. Together as his people, let us take refuge in the infinite mercy of God, our Heavenly Father, seeking his grace for the sake of Christ and saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Together we confess, Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Forgive us our sins and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Almighty God in his mercy has given his son to die for you and has raised him from death to everlasting life. For his sake, he forgives you every single one of your sins. So as a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Together, let us responsively read the introit. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who practice it have good understanding. Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with my whole heart. Great are the works of the Lord. Full of splendor and majesty is his work.
Praise
He has caused his wondrous works to be remembered.
The Lord is gracious and merciful.
He provides food for those who fear him. He sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever.
Holy and awesome is his name.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who practice it have good understanding. Seated for the next hymn. I would invite you to stand as you are able. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whom to know is everlasting life, grant us to know your Son, Jesus, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Congregation may be seated. Our Old Testament lesson this morning comes from Joshua chapter 24. This is Joshua who took over for Moses as the leader and the prophet of the Israelites as they entered into the Promised Land. He's led them. They've defeated a number of people, the Canaanites that lived in the land. Now he's getting ready to depart, and he is doing his best, as Moses did before he departed, to prepare them for what lies ahead. One of the verses that always sticks out to me is where he says to them, "Choose now whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." As Lutherans, that idea of choose can kind of make us uncomfortable. But I included a lot of the reading here in chapter 24 because it impresses upon you and us, we have been chosen. And what is the evidence? All the ways God's merciful actions for the Israelites that they did not deserve, all the ways that he fought for them, defeated them, forgave them for their sin, gave them this promised land. They are the chosen people, as we are. And as the chosen people, choose whom you will worship, whom you will serve, whom you will believe in, knowing that the Lord comes alongside you and helps you make that choice. And keep that as your choice. From Joshua 24. Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before God. Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your fathers lived beyond the Euphrates, Terah, the father of Abraham and of Nahor. They served other gods. Then I took your father Abraham from beyond the river and led him through all the land of Canaan and made his offspring many. And I gave him Isaac, and to Isaac I gave Jacob and Esau. I gave Esau the hill country of Seir to possess. But Jacob and his children went down to Egypt. And I sent Moses and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt with what I did in the midst of it. And afterward I brought you out. Then I brought your fathers out of Egypt, and you came to the sea. And the Egyptians pursued your fathers with chariots and horsemen to the Red Sea. And when they cried to the Lord, he put darkness between you and the Egyptians and made the sea come upon them and cover them. And your eyes saw what I did in Egypt. And you lived in the wilderness a long time. Then I brought you to the land of the Amorites, who live on the other side of the Jordan. They fought with you, and I gave them into your hand, and you took possession of their land, and I destroyed them before you. Then Balak, the son of Zippor, king of Moab, arose and fought against Israel, and he sent and invited Balaam, son of Beor, to curse you, but I would not listen to Balaam. Indeed, he ended up blessing you. So I delivered you out of his hand, and you went over the Jordan and came to Jericho. And the leaders of Jericho fought against you, and also the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Girgashites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. And I gave them all into your hand. And I sent the hornet before you, which drove them out before you, the two kings of the Amorites. It was not by your sword or your bow. I gave you a land on which you had not labored, and cities that you had not built, and you dwell in them. You eat the fruit of the vineyards and the olive orchards that you did not plant. Now, therefore, fear the Lord. Serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods of your fathers served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. And if it is evil in your eyes to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your fathers served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you dwell. But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our fathers up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight and preserved us in all the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for for he is our God. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle lesson comes from Ephesians 5. During these times, Sundays after Pentecost, we're reading through some of the epistles of Paul. We're reading now through Ephesians 5. In this particular section here, he talks about what it's like to serve your Lord, to choose him and serve him, what your life should look like and what it shouldn't look like, how your life should be filled with the light of Christ, and what that means for you and I, living in a world that's darkened by sin. Paul writes, "Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore do not associate with them. For at one time you were in darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, 'Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine upon you.' Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But instead be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with all your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another in reverence of Christ." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I would invite you to stand as you're able. Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus continues and finishes his bread of life discourse that we've been reading through in John 6. He's talking to people that were there for the feeding of the 5,000 and misunderstood it to be some temporal gift. And he is trying to explain that he comes to be far much more than that. Jesus said to them, "I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh." The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, "How can this man give us his flesh to eat?" So Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and as I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever." Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. When many of the disciples heard it, they said, "This is a hard saying. Who can listen to it?" But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, "Do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who those were that did not believe and who it was who would betray him. And he said, "This is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father." After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. So Jesus said to the 12, "Do you want to go away as well?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You and I have that same confession, and we can give words to it together through the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Congregation may be seated. And if there are any younger children that would like to come forward for a message, they may do so at this time. And in lieu of that, I'm going to talk to all of y'all. All of y'all who may not be younger children, but hey, you're still children at heart, right? Compared to some of the people in the Old Testament, Methuselah lived hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years. Y'all are babies in the eyes of that, aren't you? So, we're all Lutherans. How many of you are hungry? Raise your hand if you're hungry right now. Okay, raise your hand if you're going to be hungry after worship is over. Raise your hand if you got plans to go out to eat after worship. Yeah. Good plans. I mean, some of you might be going home to cook, but if you had a choice, if you had to cook and put it on the table yourself or have it served to you, how many would choose to have it cooked and served for you? Yeah, you betcha. But consider this, when you go out to eat, what do you have to do? Do you have to go back in the kitchen and help prepare it, cut and slice and put stuff on the grill? Not the places I go to eat. How many of you have to put all that food after it's cooked on the plate and bring it out to the table? Don't have to do that either. That's all done for you. When you go out to eat, it's all done for you. Is there anything you do have to do? Got to eat it, right? But how do you do that? With the utensils that are provided for you, right? You chew the food with the teeth that the Lord gave you and swallow with the throat that he gave you, and it goes into the stomach that he gave you so it can be processed and become nutritious and part of your body. Eating dinner means you got a little bit to do, but so much of it has been done already for you. With that in mind, our gospel lesson, Jesus says that he is the living bread that came down from heaven to give life to the world. What does that mean? Means he's God the Son, who came down from heaven and in the incarnation became a man, God and man at the same time. He did that so in that true body, he could go to the cross, suffer and die, give his flesh, give his blood to forgive every single one of your sins. All that he did for you. You did nothing. We didn't deserve any of that. He did that out of love for you and for me. And because of that, gives us a gift that we could never earn or deserve, and that's eternal life to come. How can you hold and have that delivered to you personally back there at the font and your baptism or through the gospel message preached to you? All of that comes with the Holy Spirit and faith. Faith is how you hold on to that. So going back to our idea of going out to eat, most of it's already done, but in our life of faith, there are some things that we do. Jesus has done everything for you to be saved, and he gives that to you through the gospel and through baptism. Your part? Believe. But you don't just believe on your own. It's not just, well, this sounds like a good idea, right? No. By the gift of faith that he gives you, you trust and you believe. Small part, because he provides everything else. If not for the gift of the faith, none of us would remain in faith. But through these words that I'm telling you, through the power of the Holy Spirit, he keeps you in that faith. He encourages you in that faith. He strengthens you in that faith. That's why I love when kids come. They need to be encouraged in that faith too. They need to have it presented to them. They need to come up here so I can look them in the eyes and talk to them in a loving way and try to be Jesus to them. So those of you that are streaming from home, and you got kids, bring them. I don't care if they make noise. I don't care if they're walking around. They need to be here because they need this as much as you need this. And we all need it. In this world, our faith is tried and tested, but the Lord brings you here to feed and to strengthen that, to give you that bread of life, life now and eternal life to come. Please join me in prayer, and you can repeat after me. Dear Jesus, thank you for doing everything necessary for me to be saved. Continue to strengthen my faith so that I believe and trust in you every day until I meet you in eternal life. In your name I pray. Amen. All right, you're all very, very good children's message people. Y'all get a star on your forehead. I'll have my marker out there on the way out, and I'll... No, we won't do that. Let's continue now with our worship, with our sermon hymn, Lord Jesus Christ, Life-Giving Bread.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. As you saw that little preview flash there, sermon today comes from our gospel reading. We're going to finish off the Bread of Life discourse. We're going to focus on especially verses 51 through 56. I've entitled it, The Living Bread That Abides. All right, it's good Lutherans. You like to go out to eat, right? We talked about that in the children's message. You like to go out to eat. Has this ever happened to you? And you don't have to confess up to it, but I'm going to. You go out to eat, you go to a place you haven't been before. And you've got this message, that just had this menu that has just way, way too many things on to choose from. And it's more than you can process. And you're with a group of people that have been there before. They're familiar with the menu. They have their favorites. Waitress comes, and then who is first to order? You, on the spot. I don't know what to order. Didn't have time to ask everybody what they're ordering, so I stick with my favorite, my safe bet. What I generally get and I know is good, and I get at other places. And then everybody else is ordering, and you're thinking, wow, that sounded good. Wow, that sounded good. And then the food comes. And you're looking at these things that people ordered, and you're like, wow, I wish I had that. I wish I had that. I wish I had that. And there's what's in front of you. I mean, it's okay. You could have probably made it at home. Just doesn't look as good as what they had. You wish you could have made a better choice. Jesus is presenting a remarkable dish to this crowd that he's speaking to. Problem is they refuse it. They don't want any part of it. Doesn't sound possible or plausible to them. Jesus says, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. And they grumble about this. How can this man give us this bread? From heaven? We know who he is. He's the carpenter's son from Nazareth. What do you mean, the bread that came down from heaven? What do you mean that we got to eat of it? Are we talking cannibalism? What the heck is going on here? So what does it mean to eat of this bread? To drink of his blood. How do we do that? And if we do, what is this life that he's going to give us? What should that look like now? What does it mean to eat of this bread? Well, first of all, we want to understand that Jesus is using a metaphor here. And the reason why he chose bread and eating is because who these people are. These are the people that were there for the feeding of the 5,000. They followed him across the sea back to Capernaum. Why? Because they want more bread. They want another bread miracle. In fact, they don't just want one more. They want it repeatedly. They bring up Moses. You think you're great? Hey, Moses, our ancestors in the wilderness, every day, 6 days a week, for 40 years, he brought bread from heaven. Why don't you do that now? Jesus didn't come to provide temporal bread. He came to provide something much, much greater. So in this vein of eating and bread, he uses that a metaphor for what he did come to bring. Keeping in mind that bread was the staple diet of everybody at that time. If you had bread, you had a meal. If you didn't have bread, you didn't. He's providing what they need for life now and eternal life to come. But they don't get it. They're focused on something else. They say to Jesus, what must we be doing to do the works of God? Because they say, eternal life, we want that. But we got to do stuff. So tell us, Jesus, what do we have to do? Jesus said, this is the work Not your work, but this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. That's what it means to eat the bread of life. So, what is this work of God that's not a work they have to do? That's what Jesus came to do. The work of God is his Son who came down from heaven and was incarnate. God the Son, the divine God the Son, member of the Trinity, came down and took on human form. More than that, he had a body like yours and like mine. A human will, a human mind, a human body. And he took that and set aside his glory for this very reason, so he could give himself on the cross for you. Jesus being the bread from heaven means that he was the atoning sacrifice for you. He talks about flesh and blood. Where did Jesus give his flesh and blood? On the cross. His flesh, whipped, beaten, bruised, and crucified. His blood poured out on the cross. Why? Out of love for you. To be your atoning sacrifice. To be the sacrifice that forgives all of your sin. To take your place and your punishment out of love for you, so you will never ever suffer that. It means earning for you what you could never earn for yourself. Forgiveness of sins, salvation, and eternal life. So you could be declared right with God, even as you continue to sin, even as you continue to disobey, declared right with God, because of all Jesus has done for you and gives you as a free gift. God's work that you could never earn or deserve or merit, but given to you anyway out of love for Christ, the gift of grace. Eating this bread means believing that Jesus is your Lord and your Savior. He did it on the cross, but how do you receive it? You're receiving it right now. Those people were receiving it from Jesus as he preached to them. We receive it through the means of grace. Catchword that sometimes we seldom take time to fulfill. The means of grace, we say, are three. God's word, preached, read, and sung. You're being fed this gift, this bread of life right now as I'm preaching it to you, as I'm telling you the gospel message. The Holy Spirit is there. He is present and he is putting that upon your heart and your life. He is laying that gift of Christ, his atoning sacrifice, in your lap. Here it is. But doesn't just leave that gift there. If not for his continued work, you'd never be able to pick it up and make it part of you. With that word and the deliverance of the gospel comes the gift of faith. The power to trust. To trust and put your hope and put your life in promises of Christ. That he is your atoning sacrifice. That even though you continue to sin, you are forgiven. That those sins are washed away from you as far as the east is from west. Every single day, every time you remember your baptism, that's the message: you are forgiven. So this gift comes to you along with faith in the Word. It came to you in the sacrament of baptism whenever you were baptized. And it's renewed right here at the altar when you partake of Christ's true body and blood in the bread and the wine. He delivers it into your lap and gives you the power to hold on to it by the Holy Spirit. Makes it yours. And we think about this metaphor with bread. We eat bread. And what happens when you eat anything? You swallow it and then it becomes a part of you, doesn't it? In a spiritual sense, when you eat by faith of Christ's work of grace, through the means of grace, it becomes yours. He becomes yours. He becomes a part of you and you become a part of him. His Spirit comes upon you never to depart. And his gifts are now yours. yours, and no one can take them away. He comes to provide and have with you a faith relationship based on love. And what is a relationship? It's what he says to us and what we say back to him. That's what the living bread comes to give you. That's what that life is supposed to be. A faith relationship with our Lord and our Savior. That recognizes him as our Savior, the only one we can go to be forgiven, and our Lord. Meaning he's not someone who redeemed us and saved us to do whatever we want. He brings us into his reign and rule, into God's family, so that we can do things that reflect that faith relationship with him. So, we have this faith relationship. What does that life look like? There's three different things I want to look at as far as that goes. The first is, you're not alone. Sometimes it might feel like you're alone. There's been times in my life when I've gone through things and it feels like I'm alone. I don't feel his presence upon me. I'm suffering. I've got worries. I've got cares. I've got griefs. You're grieving over the loss of a loved one, or the loss of a job, or even the loss of health. You've got worries that are piling upon you and piling upon you and piling upon you. You've got people surrounding you that used to support you and no longer do, no longer come around, no longer visit. Sometimes it feels like maybe he doesn't understand. He does. Understands completely. Does Jesus know what it's like to have the weight of the world fall upon your shoulders? He knows what it's like to have the weight of your sin and my sin fall upon him. Does he know what it's like to lose a loved one? He knew what it's like to mourn the death of his cousin, John the Baptist. Innocent man who was sacrificed, was martyred. He knows what it's like to have friends turn against him. 12 guys, his closest associates. One of them betrays him, and when that happens, the other 11 take off and run away. On the cross, when he takes our sin upon himself, even the Heavenly Father turns away from him and he dies alone. He knows what that life is like. He knows your cares. He knows your fears. He knows your suffering. And he is there with you, even when it doesn't feel like it. Listen to Psalm 22, one of David's Psalms. David, man after God's own heart. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night I find no rest. There's been times I've prayed words like that, and I imagine you have too. David did. A man of God, and it's there in Scripture. Is it okay to pray that prayer? Yes, if it's on your heart. But keep this in mind, David doesn't remain there. Verses 3 through 5, yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our fathers trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were rescued. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. Right after that crying out, where are you, Lord? David turns to Scripture. To the evidence of God's presence in the lives of his ancestors. The yes, he was there. He read, you can turn and read all the times in Joshua where God saved those people that were unable and were not worthy. You, in your life, when you feel abandoned, when you feel lost, when you feel like he's not there, through the power that he gives you, the power of faith, turn and trust in the promises that Jesus has made to you. Hebrews 13:5, I will never leave you or forsake you. In Christian's life, there's times when it doesn't feel like he's there. But we don't believe because of the feeling. Feelings are deceptive. Feelings come from a sinful heart. Don't trust your feelings. Trust his word. I will never leave you or forsake you. I came to you in baptism, and I remain with you even as you try to walk away from me. I reach out and call you back. Because I gave and shed my blood and broke my body on the cross for you. I did that for you out of love, and I will not let you go. Matthew 28, and behold, I am with you always to the end of the age. When you feel abandoned, commit these verses to your mind. And who is this that's saying this in Matthew 28? The one who in Matthew 18 says, all authority on heaven and earth has been given to me. The one who rules over all things. No one is higher than him. No one can contradict his will. No one can stop him. And his promise is, I am with you always. Even in the dark moments of your life, in the times when you're worried, in the times where there doesn't feel like there's any answer, any hope, there is, because I am with you. There's hope in this life, and through your faith in him, when this life is done, your spirit goes to be with him, as we talked about last week, and then you, body and soul, will live with him forever in eternal life. You're not alone. His Spirit is with you always, even and especially when it doesn't feel like it. You're fully known. He knows all about you. Now, as I reflect on that, I find it a bit uncomfortable. There's things about me that y'all don't know and that I won't ever share with you. Things that I think, things that I've done and said in the past, and I'm sure that's true in your life as well. So if I'm fully known, if I was God, I'd cast that dude out. I don't want him to be part of my kingdom. Yet he chose you before you ever chose him. He chose you before you were baptized, before you have faith, when you were dead in your trespasses and sins, when you were an awful, poor, miserable sinner. He chose you because he loves you. It's okay that you're fully known. Yes, he knows who you are. He knows who you were before faith. He knows who you are in faith. And in faith, well, we're that dichotomy. Satan, sinner at the same time. Sinners who disobey him, but saints that are declared righteous and forgiven because of that faith, because of that bread of life that's been given to us, because of that bread of life that we eat whenever, through the means of grace, we turn and hold fast to him. Fully known. Knows your fears, knows your cares, knows your worries. Knows what's going to happen today, knows what's going to happen tomorrow, and is already working in your life to take care of that according to his will, which, by the way, often does not mire your will, but his will, as the one who has authority over heaven and earth, his will is always for the best in this world and the next. He abides with you. He never leaves you. Because he's at work preparing you for what's going to happen later today and tomorrow, to give you the strength of faith, to provide everything you need to stand. And sometimes those things that happen while we don't stand, we fall and his mighty hand reaches down and picks us up, just as it did for Peter when he was walking on the water and started to sink. There was Jesus' hand pulling him up and back to him. And he's doing that in your life right now through the means of grace. He knows who you are, but don't let that trouble you. He loves you anyway, because he made you God's precious child. Fully known, fully covered by his grace, fully prepared for what's to come. All because of Jesus. Fully known, and we can turn to him, confess our sins, and believe the words of repentance, because we hold fast to his promises. You are completely forgiven for it all. You're not alone. You're fully known. And you're not your own. You were bought with a price. That's something to remember. It sounds pretty simple, but there's people that say, yeah, Jesus died for me and forgave me. He released me from bondage to sin, death, and hell. So now I'm on my own. I'm an American. I can do what I want. There are those within Christianity that say, it doesn't matter how I live. Jesus forgives all the sin. Don't need to worry about the law anymore. That's covered. He loves everybody. He does. But he is our Lord. He is the King. And just as with Joshua and the Israelites, because God chose them, they need to choose to live as obedient children. You and I need to choose to do the same thing. And we can do that because of his gift of faith that he gives us. Because we eat from that bread of life. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 6, do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit within you, whom you have from God? You are not your own, for you were bought with a price. So glorify God in your body. We talk about Jesus being our Redeemer. Redeemer means there's a price that has been paid to redeem you, to save you out of the clutches of Satan. That price puts you in Christ's kingdom and makes him your Lord. Except he's not a Lord and Master who yells down from above saying, y'all are bad, y'all are dirty, y'all are terrible. He stands beside you and says, yes, you've sinned, but I'm your Savior and I love you. Repentant and forgiven of your sin, live this way. Because you're mine. And when you mess up, by the way, I know you will, you're forgiven and restored and can do and try again and again and again and again. Living to obey, not to sin. But turning to him when we do disobey, knowing we're forgiven. Paul says in Romans 12, 1, I appeal to you therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. In this faith relationship we have with God, with him as our Lord, we are to be living sacrifices. Not to get on a cross, suffer and die and bleed. Christ already did that. We are living sacrifices in our life, giving over those things that he gives to us, our time, our talents, and our treasures. None of those belong to us. They're all gifts from him. He gives them certainly for our good. He doesn't want you to give everything away. He doesn't want you to spend all your time and energy on things and not take care of your house, not take care of your life, not take care of your family. Certainly he wants you to do that. But in all of our lives, he's given us more than what we need. And that more, whether it's time, whether it's talents, or whether it's treasures, as he directs you, share that. Share that with those that are in need. Make a phone call to the person who's lonely. Stop by their house. Invite them out for a cup of coffee. If you have the means to fix things and they need something to be fixed, set aside a time and go help them. Pray with them. And certainly, a portion of your talent, of your money, give in service to him. Doesn't have to be a tithe. It's whatever you and he work out. But in service to others. As Luther said, God doesn't need your good works. He wants your obedience. Your brother and sister, in the church and outside the church, they need it. And as a living sacrifice, we give it. And every day we fail. Every day I fail. But once again, eating of the bread of life in that faith relationship, every time I fail, I'm forgiven, and so are you. Restored and given an opportunity next time to do better. That's our life in Christ. That's our faith relationship with him. That's what it means to eat of his bread and drink of his blood. To remain in that faith relationship now and throughout our time here on this earth. He is the living bread that abides. It's a story about a young kid who was constantly late for dinner. He was a young boy. Mom would say it's time for dinner, and well, he wanted to finish the game he was playing on the computer. He wanted to finish doing this. He was having fun outside playing. He would always show up late at the table, and parents talked to him time and time again, "You need to listen and obey when we call you for dinner," until finally, one day, he was especially late. He came and sat down. His mom, his dad, his brother, all had plates full of food, stuff that he loved. And sitting in front of him was a slice of bread and a glass of water. He looks at it, dejected, broken, trying to hold back tears but unable to, thinking, "This is all I'm going to get. This is what I've chosen." Until he sees his father's hand reach in and take that plate from in front of him. And his father takes his plate full of food and places it in front of his son with a smile on his face. That's what the living bread from heaven does for you. You could never earn or deserve what he has to give you, but it's yours out of love, by grace, unearned yet yours. Jesus Christ, Lord and Savior, atoning sacrifice, he's yours, and all that he did to earn salvation, forgiveness, and eternal life, his life abiding with you now and you with him. That's the wonderful gift. That's what we live confessing and believing in. Knowing we're not alone, we're not our own, and that's okay. We serve him. So my prayer is that your confession, when all is said and done, you would continue to come here and through the means of grace, eat and partake in your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, so you can have one of the most wonderful confessions of faith, and it comes from the mouth of Peter. So often he put his foot in his mouth, but man, oh man, did he have it right here. It ends our reading. He said, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. You have the bread of life from heaven. You, and you feed us through faith. We have believed and come to know that you are the Holy One of God, my Lord and my Savior." Abide in that faith, in your relationship with him, now and until he calls you into eternal life to come. Amen. As we consider our call to be good stewards of God's gracious gifts, to be living sacrifices, know that as far as offering goes, we don't pass the plate here at Lamb of God. Whoever comes in as a visitor, we don't want them to feel obligated to give an offering. We're just glad that they're here worshiping with us. Those that would like to give an offering may drop it off in the offering box in the narthex, can bring it in during the week, can mail it in, or use our online giving portal. Our offering verses today come from Ephesians 5, verses 18 to 20. "Be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and in spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with all of your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God the Father in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ." Let's do that. Let's give thanks and praise to God. Please stand as you are able and sing our offertory.
Thank you.
Congregation may be seated for the prayers. Before we get started, there was a young gentleman, a police officer here earlier today. No, he wasn't here to take me away, at least not yet. He was here several Sundays ago. He's a Metro police officer that serves in this area. And he's not here because he had a call in the middle of our Bible study. But help me out. You know how bad I am with names. His name?
Pete.
Pete is going to be a Metro police officer right now, but Pete's headed to seminary. He wants to be a pastor. So let's pray for his safety now, but also his journey to be a shepherd in God's kingdom. We'll pray that as part of our prayers. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the family of God, for every nation, tribe, people, and language, and for those who hunger for the true bread of life, let us pray to the Lord. For consistency to work for the food that endures to eternal life through the means of grace, that we would never hunger or thirst for anything but Christ and his righteousness, let us pray to the Lord. For the ministry of this congregation and our community, that many may embrace Jesus as the Christ and believe that he is the true bread of God come down from heaven, let us pray to the Lord. For all homes and schools, especially the schools and university and the seminaries of our church, but also for the public schools and all who teach there, that we may remember the fear of the Lord as the beginning of wisdom, that they would be empowered to teach that and demonstrate that as they care for their students. Let us pray to the Lord. For Joseph, our president, Gretchen, our governor, and all those who hold offices of public trust in our land, that they would serve according to the will of God and for the good of all people, and for all law enforcement, especially our good friend Pete, as he was on a call, that he would be protected and kept safe, and for his journey to seminary and his journey to serve in God's kingdom. For all of our Metro Police and our first responders, for the judges who enforce justice on behalf of the Lord in our courts, that all would act not for selfish gain, but for the benefit of the people. Let us pray to the Lord. For the sick, including those on our prayer list, as well as these for whom special prayers have been requested. For Mikhail's wife, Jane, who's having problems with her lungs, that she would receive health and healing from the hands of the Lord and comfort and strength. Let us pray to the Lord. For these prayers and concerns that rest upon our hearts that we lift to you right now silently. For all these, that in accordance with his will, they would all receive health and healing and his presence. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those who are depressed, for all those who are lonely, for all those who are mourning the death of loved ones, that God would strengthen their faith and assure them of his presence in all circumstances. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those celebrating birthdays this week, including Phyllis Schubring, Harold Libke, Bonnie Peedy, Arthur Walter, and Nora Bradley, that as they have been given life now, they would be kept in steadfast faith unto eternal life to come. Let us pray to the Lord. For all those who are celebrating anniversaries this week and in the past, including James Rush and Tika, that they would be united and kept united in the love of Christ, and they would grow in that love and that faith toward him and one another. Let us pray to the Lord. O Lord, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember the sufferings and death of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, for our salvation. Rejoicing in his victorious resurrection from the dead, we draw strength from his ascension before you, where he ever stands for us as our own high priest. Gather us together from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us For to you alone we give all glory, honor, and worship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
I would invite you now to stand as you are able. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, O Lord, Holy Father, almighty and everlasting God, for the countless blessings you so freely bestow on us and all creation. Above all, we give thanks for your boundless love shown to us when you sent your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, into our flesh and laid on him our sin, giving him into death that we might not die eternally. Because he is now risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity, all who believe in him will overcome sin and death and will rise again to new life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and saying, taught by our Lord and trusting in his promises, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it. He gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also he took the cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you. depart now with his joy and his peace, knowing that all of your sins have been forgiven. Amen. Depart now with his joy and his peace, knowing that all of your sins have been forgiven. Thank you.
Thank you.
Please stand as you are able. May this, the true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen you body and soul to life everlasting. Depart in his joy and his peace.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, our Heavenly Father, you have given us a foretaste of the feast to come in the Holy Supper of your Son's body and blood. Keep us firm in the true faith throughout our days of pilgrimage, that on the day of his coming we may, together with all your saints, celebrate the marriage feast of the Lamb and his kingdom, which has no end. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his peace. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
The love and peace of Christ Jesus, your Savior, has been poured out upon you richly and abundantly this day. In the same manner he has shared with you, pour out these gifts upon those around you who need to hear the gospel from your lips and by the works of your hands. In doing so, we serve the world as his church. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.